And welcome to a very special pre-recorded video here on the Foundation's internal website, or the intranet, which all employees, including yourself, have been asked to attend, regardless of your experience level, whether you are an intern, a new hire, or an experienced director or overseer. As you know, there is no shortage of anomalies that the Foundation continues to secure, contain, and protect. However, recently there has been a shortage of trained professionals, doctors, and various medical staff who are either willing to join or be recruited by the Foundation or able to maintain their tenure here. The reason for that is that the ongoing research, experiments, and engagement with the various anomalies can be quite stressful. Many of the trained medical professionals and doctors often experience extreme forms of anxiety, stress, and even PTSD, and in some of the worst cases, often are either outright murdered by the anomalies, disintegrated, or disappear into another dimension. So that is why I have been tasked by my superiors as well to create this video. In an effort to obtain as many volunteers, again, as I said earlier, no matter what your employee level, experience level, to assist with the research of the various anomalies. So periodically, I will be publishing these videos, again here on the internal Foundation website, where I will be reviewing various anomaly files so that you can choose which ones that you would like to assist with, either creating sketches, obtaining photographs, visiting the sites, providing your experience, what you see, anything you hear, helping with interviews, conducting tests, etc. Now, this video should only take up about an hour of your time. If you happen to fall asleep, because I know it may be quite boring, you can feel free to come back and pick up where you left off. I will leave some annotations in the description of this video listing each file and the time that it is reviewed within this video, okay, for your ease of reference. And then once every quarter or so, the next video in this series will probably be published sometime the first quarter of 2020. And again, I've selected a random set of some of the more well-known anomalies, and I will go over each one, spend a few minutes on them. I know some of you may be very familiar with these. Some of you may not, all depending upon your work experience here at the Foundation, but you can consider this somewhat of a refresher, and maybe give you some insight into some of the anomalies that you may not be familiar with. And again, whichever ones you choose to assist with and volunteer to aid in the research, please just report to your overseer and superiors and let them know, all right? Okay, well, why don't we get started? Let's see, the first anomaly that I have is SCP-055. What I'll do is go over some of the description of the anomaly and some of the containment procedures as well, just to give an idea of what might be in store for you should you volunteer and wish to assist with the research and containment. SCP-055 is a self-keeping secret or anti-meme. Information about SCP-055's physical appearance, as well as its nature, behavior, and origins, is self-classifying. To clarify, how Site-19 originally acquired SCP-055 is unknown. When SCP-055 was obtained, and by whom, is unknown. SCP-055's physical appearance is unknown. It is not indescribable or invisible. Individuals are perfectly capable of entering SCP-055's container and observing it, taking mental or written notes, making sketches, taking photographs, and even making audio-video recordings. However, information about its physical appearance leaks out of a human mind soon after such an observation. Individuals tasked with describing it afterwards find their minds wandering and lose interest in the task, unable to remember what the photograph looks like, as are researchers overseeing these tests. Security personnel who have observed SCP-055 via closed-circuit television cameras emerge after a full shift, exhausted and effectively amnesiac about the events of the previous hours. Who authorized the construction of SCP-055's containment room, why it was constructed in this way, or what the purpose of the described containment procedures may be, are all unknown. Despite SCP-055's container being easily accessible, all personnel at Site-19 claim no knowledge of SCP-055's existence when challenged. All of these facts are periodically rediscovered, usually by chance readers of this file, causing a great deal of alarm. This state of concern lasts minutes, at most, before the matter is simply forgotten about. A great deal of scientific data has been recorded from SCP-055, but cannot be studied. At least one attempt has been made to destroy SCP-055, or possibly move it from containment at Site-19 to another site, meeting failure for reasons unknown. SCP-055 may present a major physical threat, and indeed may have killed many hundreds of personnel, and we would not know it. Certainly, it presents a gigantic, mimetic, mental threat, hence its Keter classification. As for the special containment procedures, SCP-055 is kept within a 5x5 by 2.5 meter square room constructed of cement, 50 centimeter thickness, with a Faraday cage surrounding the cement walls. Access is via a heavy containment door measuring 2x2.5 meters, constructed on bearings to ensure door closes and locks automatically unless held open deliberately. Security guards are not to be posted outside of its room. It is further advised that all personnel maintaining or studying other SCP objects in the vicinity try to maintain a distance of at least 50 meters from the geometric center of the room, as long as this is reasonably practical. Okay, so there you have it, SCP-055. Again, should you be interested in volunteering to aid in the ongoing research and keeping updates onto that anomaly, please refer to your superior and let them know, okay? All right, moving on to the next anomaly. Thank you. We have SCP-001, also known as Dr. Clef's proposal. SCP-001 is a humanoid entity, approximately 700 cubits in height, located in an undisclosed location near the intersection of the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. The following features are known about the entity: a number of luminous, wing-like appendages emerging from the shoulders, back, temples, ankles, and wrists of the entity. Although an accurate count has never been established, most observers place the number of wings and anywhere from 2 through 108, with the mean number being 4. A weapon, possibly a sword or knife, SCP-001-2. The weapon appears to emit flames at a temperature rivaling that of the sun, based on spectrographic analysis, although there appear to be no destructive effects from the intense heat on the surrounding area. SCP-001 appears to be standing with its head bowed in a gesture of supplication, with SCP-001-2 held in both hands, point down in front of it. Since originally recorded by the founder over, data has been redacted, years ago, SCP-001 has not deviated from this stance. Human beings exposed to SCP-001 report hearing a voice in their heads, giving them a directive which the subject reports cannot be disobeyed. The most common directive is forget, which results in the subject walking away from SCP-001 with no memory of having encountered it. On rare occasions, however, other directives have been given. The most famous of these is the one given to the founder, prepare, which he has claimed formed the impetus for founding, that information has been redacted, to catalog and contain any and all supernatural and or paranormal artifacts that represent a serious threat to the current existence of humanity. Also, observers have reported that SCP-001 appears to be standing in front of a gate of immense proportions. Long-range photographs have occasionally detected what appears to be a pastoral grove within, containing numerous other entities of the same composition as SCP-001, as well as several fruit trees of unknown composition. It is the avowed belief of the founder that the gate which SCP-001 guards may be the gate to, data has been expunged from the file, based on correlations with ancient Babylonian texts and the Dead Sea Scrolls, in which case one can deduce that the entity known as SCP-001 may be, and that data has been expunged as well. Now, there is a lot more information on this particular entity or anomaly, as well as with all the other anomalies that I will be reviewing here. But due to time constraints, I cannot go over each file in great detail. Okay, so, of course, all the information is available here on the Foundation's intranet site, should you wish to gather more information before you, in case you want to make an informed decision on which anomaly you wish to volunteer in assisting with the research, okay? And why don't we just go over special containment procedures. Because of the nature of SCP-001, no containment procedures are necessary. 24/7 monitoring of it is to take place from a safe distance from a predetermined location known as Site Zero. The location of Site Zero is known only to the current SCP administrator and the single overseer-level agent of Abrahamic Faith, 05-14, assigned to monitor SCP-001 from Site Zero. What else? Should SCP-001 become active in any way, personnel are required to immediately consult the Patmos series of emergency orders, decoding algorithms for emergency order Patmos are to be maintained on site at Site Zero in the possession of the designated observer and are to be transmitted to SCP Foundation offices only in the event of SCP-001 becoming active. Foundation personnel with vital roles in one or more variants of emergency procedure, PATMOS, P-A-T-M-O-S, it's an acronym, are to be advised to take the following precautions. And there's a list of precautions there that you can read about, again, available on the Foundation website, okay? Alright, so that is SCP-001. Next file we have SCP-4999. SCP-4999 is a humanoid entity of unknown composition, visually resembling a middle-aged male. Its physical appearance varies, with its dark suit being the only constant between manifestations. Due to the rarity of recorded SCP-4999 manifestation events and the highly specific circumstances in which they occur, little data concerning its nature or intent is available. However, its behavior is consistent across all recorded sightings. SCP-4999 will manifest only in the presence of one solitary human person at a time. All subjects recorded to date have been in terminally poor health, critically injured, or on their deathbeds, with SCP-4999 appearing nearby and within sight of the individual not more than 20 minutes before their expiration. SCP-4999 will only appear if the subject is conscious and alone. It will not appear if the subject is comatose, asleep, or unconscious, nor will it appear if they are being cared for by, in the company of, or otherwise being directly observed by another person. Upon manifestation, the entity will seat itself directly adjacent to the subject's bed, if such furniture is available. If not, it will remain standing or sit on the floor or ground in whatever configuration will allow it direct physical access to the subject without causing disturbance. Once situated, it will remove a pack of cigarettes from its left inside jacket pocket and offer one to the subject. If the subject accepts, SCP-4999 will place it between their lips, remove one for itself, and light both. If the subject declines, SCP-4999 will light and smoke the cigarette instead. The entity will make physical contact with the subject, typically via holding their hand, placing its hand atop theirs, or resting its hand on their shoulder. SCP-4999 will then remain with the subject, silent and unmoving, until they have passed away. SCP-4999 has not been seen to engage in any other activity or behavior, and demanifests immediately upon the subject's death. The subject's cigarette, however, will remain, providing the only physical evidence of SCP-4999's presence. Individuals affected by SCP-499 share a number of common attributes, such as living alone, is impoverished or homeless, is a military vet, is unmarried or otherwise lacks a significant other, and other examples. As far as its discovery, SCP-4999 was initially discovered as a result of its emerging status as an urban legend, with footage of the entity appearing on hospital security cameras worldwide being disseminated via the internet and various television programs. In years following its classification, additional research and cross-referencing with accounts of similar phenomena have suggested that while concrete evidence of SCP-4999 appearances has become more commonplace due to the advent of photography and video recording technology in the modern era, writings and artistic depictions of the figure exhibiting similar properties, behavior, and physical resemblance to the anomaly exist throughout world history, culture, and mythology, with some accounts being thousands of years old, in some cases predating human civilization. It is not currently understood how pre-modern cultures would have been capable of detecting SCP-4999's presence. Investigation is ongoing, which again is a reason why we're looking for volunteers to assist with these anomalies, especially SCP-4999. And just a little information about its containment procedures. Due to SCP-4999's unwillingness or inability to appear before more than one person at a time, in addition to the subsequent and immediate death of any who witness it firsthand, it is effectively self-containing. Any reports of SCP-4999 manifestations captured by security camera feeds, photographs, or similar are to be investigated and the media confiscated for analysis. All secondhand witnesses among the civilian populace are to be amnesticized. Okay. Alright, so that is SCP-4999. And again, if you do have any questions, please, I would defer you to your superiors, okay? Next, we have SCP-1000, Object Class Keter. Description: SCP-1000 is a nocturnal omnivorous ape classified in the hominini branch along with genera Pan and Homo. Adults range in size from 1.5 to 3 meters, 5 to 10 feet in height, and weigh between 200 to 600 pounds. They have gray, brown, black, red, and occasionally white fur. They possess large eyes with good vision, a pronounced brow ridge, and a sagittal crest on the forehead similar to that of the gorilla, but present in both sexes. Their intelligence is on par with that of Pan troglodytes, the common chimpanzee. SCP-1000 evolved alongside Homo sapiens, existing contemporaneously with proto-humans and humans in large numbers until about 10,000 to 15,000 years ago, when an extinction event eliminated all but 1 to 5% of their population. This event was triggered by SCP-1000 contracting an anomalous pseudo-disease classified as SCP-1000-F1. This disease is passed on at the genetic level and affects every present-day instance of SCP-1000. The majority of SCP-1000 instances are born immune to the effect. Those who are not born immune quickly die. Then we have some information about the effect of SCP-1000-F1, which you can read further on your own time. Because of SCP-1000's close relation to humanity, it is considered likely that SCP-1000-F1 could eventually transfer to human carriers. In any instance of SCP-1000 finding its way to a major population center could constitute a redacted information class end of the world scenario with a minimum death toll of redacted again and possible extinction of humanity. Fortunately, SCP-1000 appears to instinctively avoid human contact. It is not currently feasible to exterminate SCP-1000 entirely. The highest known population concentrations of SCP-1000 are at present located in the Pacific Northwest region of North America and the Himalayan mountain region in Asia. SCP-1000 came to the attention of the Foundation via contact by Dr. Friends, whose last name has been redacted. In a time, it's also been expunged from the file with the Children of the Sun, who identified themselves as outcast members of the Serpent's Hand. This group has since been completely destroyed by the Foundation due to their reluctance to surrender information about SCP-1000. Remaining members have either joined the Foundation or have gone into hiding, presumably as members of the Serpent's Hand. Let's see, what else? Okay, so that is some of the basic information about SCP-1000, which is also known as Bigfoot. Alright, here is information about the special containment procedures. All media reports related to SCP-1000 are to be examined for potential verifiability. All organizations and individuals investigating its existence are to be kept under surveillance by Mobile Task Force Zeta-1000 and discredited or administered amnestics. All physical signs of SCP-1000's existence must be retrieved and kept in Foundation custody and replaced with decoy items if necessary. Alleged sightings of the anomaly must always be investigated by MTF Zeta-1000, however trivial the claim. Absolutely no contact with wild or captive instances of SCP-1000 is allowed without prior approval by Director Jones. Any interaction with it and humans, including Foundation personnel, must be reported to Director Jones immediately. Okay. Okay, that was SCP-1000. Moving on. Next we have SCP-087. SCP-087 is an unlit platform staircase. Stairs descend on a 38-degree angle for 13 steps before reaching a semicircular platform of approximately 3 meters in diameter. Descent direction rotates 180 degrees at each platform. The design of SCP-087 limits subjects to a visual range of approximately 1.5 flights. A light source is required for any subjects exploring SCP-087, as there are no lighting fixtures or windows present. Lighting sources brighter than 75 watts have shown to be ineffective, as SCP-087 seems to absorb excess light. Subjects report and audio recordings confirm the distressed vocalizations from what is presumed to be a child between the ages of... The information has been redacted. The source of the distress calls is estimated to be located approximately 200 meters below the initial platform. However, any attempts to descend the staircase have failed to bring subjects closer to the source. The depth of descent, calculated from Exploration 4, the longest exploration, is shown to be far beyond both the possible structure of both the building and geological surroundings. At this time, it is unknown if SCP-087 has an endpoint. SCP-087 has undergone 4 video recorded explorations by Class D personnel. Each subject conducting an exploration has encountered SCP-087-1, which appears as a face with no visible pupils, nostrils, or mouth. The nature of SCP-087-1 is entirely unclear, but it has been determined that it is not the source of the pleading. Subjects exhibit feelings of intense paranoia and fear when faced with SCP-087-1, but it is undetermined whether said feelings are abnormal or simply natural reactions. an addendum here. Over a period of 2 weeks following exploration four, several members of the staff and students from the information has been redacted. Tickler campus reported knocking at a variable rate of 1 to 2 seconds per knock coming from the interior of SCP-087. The door leading to SCP-087 has been fitted with 6-centimeter-thick industrial padding. All reports of knocking have ceased. And as for the special containment procedures, SCP-087 is located on the campus of, well, that information has been redacted, but if you so choose to volunteer to assist with the research, ongoing investigation, that information will be provided to you by your superiors. The doorway leading to SCP-087 is constructed of reinforced steel with an electrical release lock mechanism. It has been disguised to resemble a janitorial closet consistent with the design of the building. The lock mechanism on the doorknob will not release unless a certain amount of volts are applied in conjunction with counterclockwise rotation of the key. Okay, and again, more information is available on the Foundation's website should you need it. Next, we have SCP-426. Object Class Euclid. Description. Hello, I am SCP-426. I must be introduced this way in order to prevent ambiguity. I am an ordinary toaster, able to toast bread when supplied with electricity. However, when any human being mentions me, they inadvertently refer to me in the first person. Despite all attempts, there is yet to be a way to speak or write about me in the third person. When in my continuous presence for over 2 months, individuals begin to identify themselves as a toaster. Unless forcibly restrained, these people will ultimately harm themselves in their attempts to emulate my standard functions. I was discovered in the home of a particular family after the gruesome deaths of 3 of its members. I have been given to the younger members of the family as a wedding gift. No card or any other identifying markings had been found on my box. Approximately 2 months after the family received me, fire crews were dispatched to the home due to an electrical fire. The younger member of the family died from the electric discharge that she had caused when attempting to devour an electric socket. The other 2 victims had died shortly before the fire occurred. The elder member of the family had engorged herself with nearly 10 kilograms of bread before her stomach burst, and she died of internal bleeding. The younger mister of the family died of severe blood loss after attempting, information has been redacted, with me. The sole survivor was the elder member of the family who was suffering from severe malnutrition. He stated that he had inserted some bread a week prior and was still waiting for the toast to pop out. I was confiscated by the Foundation after police noted my unusual properties. A Class C amnestic was administered to the affected officers. And now for some of the special containment procedures. I am to be sealed in a chamber with no windows through which I may be viewed. The door to my chamber must have a label completely unrelated to my designation or identity in order to prevent unintended spread of my primary effect. Only level 3 and above personnel are to know of my presence, and particularly of my properties. Assigned personnel are to be rotated out on a monthly basis to prevent contamination by my secondary effect. Psychiatric evaluation is mandatory at the end of the month. If personnel are deemed unaffected, they may be reassigned to me no less than 4 months after their last rotation with me. Okay. And again, for any additional information, you can refer to the Foundation's internal website. Where further details are provided. Okay. So SCP-426, again, looking for you or anyone else that may be willing to volunteer. It's ongoing research. Next file. SCP-902. Object class Keter. Description: SCP-902 is a box, roughly the size of an adult human head. It measures 30 centimeters by 15 centimeters by 19 centimeters. It appears to be an ammunition box of a type used roughly 30 years ago, despite this item having been in Foundation custody for roughly 60 years. SCP-902 is made of lead. The composition of the item inside SCP-902 is unknown. SCP-902 emits what has been described as a ticking sound, and anyone who hears this sound becomes convinced that the item is counting down. When opened, the box appears empty. However, the ticking remains. The object continues counting down. Anyone who becomes aware of SCP-902, whether through personal interaction or by reading this report, becomes convinced that whatever is in the box is horribly dangerous and needs to be destroyed as soon as it finishes counting down, and not before. Staff exposed to SCP-902 will typically continue to attempt to open and then close the box, trying to find the object inside. There is no object. There is an object. It has to be destroyed when the countdown stops. We are doing great work. We have to be stopped. And now for some information about the containment procedures. SCP-902 has been relegated to Arctic Base Theta 12, the only SCP to be contained at this site. The site is to be staffed by a team of 50 security personnel. Knowledge of SCP-902 beyond its number is to be limited to Level 3 staff and lower. However, of course, we are making an exception at this time due to the nature of this video and the circumstances. It is imperative that only a limited number of senior staff know of the existence of SCP-902. Only one O5 overseer level is allowed to know about SCP-902 at any time. In the event of a security breach from inside Arctic Base Theta 12, the on-site hydrogen bomb is to be detonated remotely. SCP-902 must be guarded at all times against premature destruction. Okay. So there you have it. SCP-902 available for anyone for you willing to participate in its ongoing observation. Next file. We have SCP-294, object class Euclid. Description: Item SCP-294 appears to be a standard coffee vending machine. The only noticeable difference being an entry touchpad with buttons corresponding to an English QWERTY keyboard. Upon depositing 50 cents U.S. currency into the coin slot, the user is prompted to enter the name of any liquid using the touchpad. Upon doing so, a standard 12-ounce paper drinking cup is placed and the liquid indicated is poured. 97 initial test runs were performed, including requests for water, coffee, beer, soda, etc., and each one returned a success. Test runs with solid materials such as diamond have failed, however, as it appears that SCP-294 can only deliver substances that can exist in liquid state. It is of note that after approximately 50 uses, the machine would not respond to further requests. After a period of approximately 90 minutes, the machine seemed to have restocked itself. It is also interesting to note that many caustic liquids that would have eaten through a normal paper cup seem to have no effect on the cups dispensed by the machine. Testing is ongoing, which is why we need your hoping to get some volunteers and your help. As suggested, SCP-294 was moved to the second floor personnel break room as a money-saving venture. Following incident 294-01, which you can read more about on the Foundation's site, guards were stationed at the item and a security clearance became necessary to interact with it. As for the special containment procedures, there are no standard special containment procedures on file for the item SCP-294. However, only personnel of security clearance level 2 or higher are allowed to interact with it. Of course, that is subject to change should you wish to volunteer in its research. And again, SCP-294 is currently on the second floor break room and is to be monitored by two guards of security clearance level 3 at all times. Okay. So that is SCP-294. Next, we have SCP-3008, Object Class Euclid. SCP-3008 is a large retail unit previously owned by and branded as IKEA, a popular furniture retail chain. A person entering SCP-3008 through the main entrance and then passing out of sight of the doors will find themselves translocated to SCP-3008-1. This displacement will typically go unnoticed, as no change will occur from the perspective of the victim. They will generally not become aware until they try to return to the entrance. SCP-3008-1 is a space resembling the inside of an IKEA furniture store, extending far beyond the limits of what could physically be contained within the dimensions of the retail unit. Current measurements indicate an area of at least 10 square kilometers, with no visible external terminators detected in any direction. Inconclusive results from the use of laser rangefinders has led to the speculation that the space may be infinite. SCP-3008-1 is inhabited by an unknown number of civilians trapped within prior to containment. Gathered data suggests they have formed a rudimentary civilization within SCP-3008-1, including the construction of settlements and fortifications for the purpose of defending against SCP-3008-2, which are humanoid entities that exist within SCP-3008-1. While superficially resembling humans, they possess exaggerated and inconsistent bodily proportions, often described as being too short or too tall. They possess no facial features, and in all observed cases, wear a yellow shirt and blue trousers consistent with the IKEA employee uniform. Okay, some more information there available on the Foundation's website, but that should give you a good idea, for starters, as to whether or not you want to volunteer in researching this anomaly. As for the special containment procedures, the retail park containing SCP-3008 has been purchased by the Foundation and converted into a site. Information has been kept confidential. All public roads leading to or passing by the site have been redirected. Should you volunteer, you'll get information as to which site that is. The entrance to SCP-3008 is to be monitored at all times, and no one is to enter it outside of testing as permitted by the senior researcher. Humans exiting SCP-3008 are to be detained and then debriefed prior to the administration of amnestics. Dependent upon the duration of their stay in SCP-3008, a cover story may need to be generated prior to their release. Any other entities exiting SCP-3008 are to be terminated. Okay. All right, on to the next file. Do a few more here. This is what can be considered SCP-4000. Object class Keter. We'll go over the special containment procedures in a moment. The SCP in question is an extra-dimensional forested area with numerous anomalous qualities, including a hazardous nomenclative phenomenon. This anomalous location is accessed by performing 4000-Holloway. Please refer to document DOC-4000H in that regard. After completing the procedure, subjects emerge from the opening of a dilapidated brick well fixed into the forest floor. The only way to reliably traverse the unusual terrain is by use of a single dirt path. Exploration that diverged from said route have resulted in immediate loss of contact with participating subjects. The sole safe road may only be traversed in a single direction, and any attempt by subjects to turn back and return the way they came will result in similar loss of contact. The unnamed world does not adhere to the constraints of linear space. Cartographic endeavors have resulted in vastly different routes being recorded with each expedition, and sections of the mandatory trail which should logically overlap or intersect do not. The only consistency in the layout is the access point, which is always located at both ends of the main road. The only way for a subject to safely exit the woods, which have no name, after they have begun following it is by walking its entire length and returning to the place where they began at the opposite end. A variety of anomalous entities native to the nameless habitat have been documented. Native entities often undergo changes in physical structure when unobserved, which has made it difficult for researchers to determine which recorded entities are unique beings and which are newer iterations of those previously documented. Entities claim they have no control over these changes and frequently express dissatisfaction when they occur. Native entities often obstruct the trail which subjects tread, making it necessary for subjects to interact with them to progress. Native entities are sapient and often highly temperamental, but can be interacted with safely as long as 4000 SEP precautions are followed. Consequences for disregarding these precautions will vary depending upon the personality of the offended entity. Degrees of retribution encountered by research subjects have included verbal rebuke, acts of violence, and anomalous alteration of the subject's physical, conceptual, or nomenclative attributes. Of course, more information on this particular anomaly is available on the intranet. As far as the containment procedures, the extra-dimensional location described as well as the entities and landmarks contained therein are nomenclative hazards, issue class, and therefore may not be referred to by any name, title, or designation. Only descriptions may be used when referring to the forest outside normative space and native entities thereof. Variations must be made in these descriptions each time a subject is described. Descriptions may be color-coded for clarity, and florid language may be used for the sake of nomenclative diversity. All right, let's see. Lastly, in accordance with Order 05-4000-F26, at least one successful expedition into the strange and dangerous woodland area must be carried out per year, which is why we're looking for volunteers, to assess any deviations from baseline abnormality. Due to the high risk involved in entering the place where the nameless are found, personnel sent in to conduct research must be trained in standard exploration protocol as detailed in 4000 SCP. Okay. We'll just finish up with two more. Next we have SCP-231. A lot of information about this anomaly has been kept confidential, and you'll need certain security clearances in order to view it. I cannot relay any of that information here in this video, but should you wish to volunteer in assisting with the research of this anomaly, you will gain access to aforementioned redacted info. SCP-231-7 is a female of a certain years of age with data expunged. SCP-231-1-7 were retrieved from a certain locale following a police raid on a warehouse owned by an organization called the Children of the Scarlet King. The particular newspaper titled Police Raid Satanic Sex Cult Save 7. 24 hours after the rescue, SCP-231-1, whose real name, redacted, went into labor pains, giving birth 3 minutes later to SCP. Again, the information has been kept confidential. Causing a particular event, resulting in over a certain amount of confirmed casualties. Foundation personnel immediately took possession of remaining SCPs 2312 through 2317, and based on notebooks recovered from the cult, instituted procedure 110 Montauk to prevent future occurrences. And that is not much information as for the description, so why don't we talk about the site and personnel requirements and the special containment procedures. And I forgot to mention, this is Object Class Cuter. All personnel assigned to SCP-231-7 must rotate out for 1 month of psychological counseling after 2 months on site. SCP-231-7 is to be kept in an undisclosed location, which you'll receive the information on location should you choose to volunteer for this. All personnel assigned to the anomaly will be transported there blindfolded from Site 19 by a route including no fewer than 7 different forms of transportation, including but not limited to aircraft, automobile, underground tunnel, and redacted. Removal of the blindfold during the transport process is grounds for immediate termination. Personnel assigned to SCP-231-7 must undergo heavy psychological testing before being cleared to enter the site. Individuals must score at least 72 points on the Milgram Obedience Examination, be unmarried, have no offspring, and express nothing less than total loyalty to the Foundation. Now, let's see, what else? Personnel who express sympathy towards SCP-231-7's plight and or express a desire to rescue or sympathize towards it will be transferred to another project without delay. Any actual rescue attempts will be met with immediate termination. While on site, individuals assigned to SCP-231-7 will be issued concealing helmets with integrated voice changers to protect their identity. 6 Class D personnel are to be assigned to it each month for the purpose of carrying out Procedure 110 Montauk. Violent criminals are not to be used for this purpose due to the possibility of accidental fatality during the 110 Montauk process. As for the special containment procedures, following repeated escape and suicide attempts, and based on the failure of containment for SCP-231-6, containment of SCP-231-7 has been amended to the following. SCP-231 is to be contained within a soundproof holding cell adjacent to holding cells for 6 Class D personnel assigned for the purposes of Procedure 110 Montauk. Cameras will monitor every inch of the cell at all times and must be manned 24 hours a day. And lastly, SCP-231-7 is to be kept restrained to a hospital bed at all times, except for the purposes of Procedure 110 Montauk. Hydration will be provided through IV drip. Feeding will be carried out twice per day through feeding tube by approved medical personnel who have not taken the Hippocratic Oath. Under no circumstances are narcotics, anesthesia, or other unapproved medications to be administered to the anomaly. Okay. So again, more information is available on the Foundation's intranet site, should you wish to volunteer. Okay, we are getting close to the end now, but we have time for just one more file. I have about 6 or 7 others, but unfortunately it would take up too much time here for the purpose of this video. So we will return again, like I stated earlier, first quarter of 2020. Although it's possible that my superiors may ask me to do this more frequently than once a quarter. Next we have SCP-106, Object Class Keter. Okay, well, we can start with a special containment procedures to start this time. No physical interaction with SCP-106 is allowed at any time. All physical interaction must be approved by no less than 2/3 vote from O5 Command. Any such interaction must be undertaken in AR-2 maximum security sites after a general non-essential staff evacuation. SCP-106 is to be contained in a sealed container comprised of lead-lined steel. The container will be sealed within 40 layers of identical material, each layer separated by no less than 36 centimeters of empty space. Support struts between layers are to be randomly spaced. Container is to remain suspended no less than 60 centimeters from any surface by ELOIID electromagnetic supports. Secondary containment area is to be comprised of 16 spherical cells, each filled with various fluids and a random assembly of surfaces and supports. Secondary containment is to be fitted with light systems capable of flooding the entire assembly with no less than 80,000 lumens of light instantly with no direct human involvement. Any corrosion observed on any containment cell surfaces, staff members or other site locations within 200 meters of SCP-106 are to be reported to site security immediately. Any objects or personnel lost to SCP-106 are to be deemed missing KIA. No recovery attempts are to be made under any circumstances. There is an additional note here. Continued research and observation, which again is why we need your you or someone else to assist with, have shown that when faced with highly complex random assemblies of structures, SCP-106 can be confused, showing a marked delay on entry and exit from said structure. SCP-106 has also shown an aversion to direct sudden light. This is not manifested in any form of physical damage, but a rapid exit into the pocket dimension generated on solid surfaces. All right, now as for the description, SCP-106 appears to be an elderly humanoid with a general appearance of advanced decomposition. This appearance may vary, but the rotting quality is observed in all forms. SCP-106 is not exceptionally agile and will remain motionless for days at a time, waiting for prey. It is capable of scaling any vertical surface and can remain suspended upside down indefinitely. When attacking, it will attempt to incapacitate prey by damaging major organs, muscle groups, or tendons, then pull disabled prey into its pocket dimension. SCP-106 appears to prefer human prey items in the 10 to 25 years of age bracket. It causes a corrosion effect in all solid matter it touches, engaging a physical breakdown in materials several seconds after contact. This is observed as rusting, rotting, and cracking of materials, and the creation of a black, mucus-like substance similar to material coating SCP-106. This effect is particularly detrimental to living tissues and is assumed to be a pre-digestion act. Corrosion continues for 6 hours after contact, after which the effects appear to burn out. SCP-106 is capable of passing through solid matter, leaving behind a large patch of its corrosive mucus. It is able to vanish inside solid matter, entering what is assumed to be a form of pocket dimension. It is then able to exit this dimension from any point connected to the initial entry point. Examples: entering the inner wall of a room and exiting the outer wall. Entering a wall and exiting from the ceiling. It is unknown if this is the point of origin for SCP-106 or a simple lair created by it. Okay. So that is just, again, some of the brief information about this particular SCP. You can read more about it on the Foundation intranet site, should you wish to volunteer in aiding and assisting with its ongoing research. All right, and that will conclude this video. Again, I would like to thank you for your attendance, and I hope that you have found a particular anomaly that you will be interested in helping the Foundation and its ongoing research and details, etc. And again, look for another video like this to be published, most likely sometime in the first quarter of 2020, if not sooner. It all depends on what my superiors wish and how often they need to get these out for everyone and disseminated to all employees. Okay, that will do it. Thanks again. Take care of yourself and good luck. And thanks for all the great work that you do for the Foundation. All right, so long now. Okay. Let's see which ones we didn't get a chance to get to. Save these for the next video. SCP-999. SCP-096, SCP-682, SCP-1981, SCP-2000, SCP-093, SCP-914, SCP-049, and SCP-173. Okay, save those for the next video.